Welcome to this PTGui tutorial series. In this segment, having just stitched together a spherical panorama in the previous one, we'll take a look at the result and how it presents itself. In particular, we'll discuss the particularities of the equirectangular projection, that's the projection used to display and store a full spherical 360 by 180 degree panorama. We'll then look at a number of different options for viewing that panorama as you work with it and when you're done with it. And finally, we'll just discuss the image parameter and optimizer tab a little bit. So let's start afresh rather than continue where we left off last time. The reason being, I just want to show you that you can do pretty much everything we did last time just with a click on that Align Images button. What that button does, it generates control points, it optimizes your project, it sneakily deletes the worst control points, it fits the panorama if it's a partial one, it chooses a suitable projection, in this case it chose the equirectangular projection, and it even tries to level the panorama. Now, the leveling worked well in this case because when I shot this panorama here in the tunnel, I actually leveled my tripod with a bubble level on the panoramic tripod head. And when you do this, the leveling function up here will actually do a good job. If you have not leveled your panoramic tripod head, that's not a problem. You can just use the editor here. And we showed you before, when you're dragging this vertically, you move the center of the image up and down, so you're changing the pitch of it. When you're dragging horizontally, you change the yaw. And finally, when you control click and drag, you can change the roll. So in this case here, if I increase the size of the image a little bit, I could try to kind of level it like this manually again. Or, and we will show this in a separate tutorial, you can use vertical line type control points. And by using those, you can be very, very accurate in leveling those. All right, so now we've got this view here again that you've seen before, and this is what we call the equirectangular projection. So equirectangular, just for the word, actually means it preserves right angles. So anything that's a right angle in real life will be a right angle even in this sort of projection here. But what's all this stuff about projections? Well, if you think about what are we doing when we capture a full 360 by 180 panorama? Well, we're standing in one spot and we're taking pictures all around us, up and down and left and right in all directions. And what we're doing essentially is with these pictures, think you're sitting inside of a sphere and you're using these pictures as wallpaper and you're just wallpapering the inside of the sphere until you get the view that you had then and there in that particular spot that you were standing or that your camera was. So you end up with a spherical representation, so a sphere of what you saw at the time. But as you can probably guess, computers usually have a hard time working with spheres, especially when you're using things like the JPEG or the TIFF format. That's nothing with 3D to do, like a sphere that's a 3D object. It's just a flat thing. So you need to take that sphere and somehow transform it into a rectangular view. And if you think a little bit back about your geography class, well, that's the exact same problems that cartographers have when they're trying to map the Earth onto a map, which is typically a rectangular object. So there are many projections for that, again, like you probably remember from geography class, but in this case, we always work with the equirectangular projection. And the reason for that is both historical and it's practical, and it's, as many things, a compromise between a whole bunch of desired properties. But to make this a little bit more intuitive for you, I made this little animation here, and you can look at this yourself on the website. So here we've got our equirectangular projection of the Earth, and you're probably more familiar also with this kind of view when you're seeing the Earth from the outside. What I did now is I've highlighted a bunch of interesting regions, which is the North Pole in this case here, the South Pole, and this blue line here in the middle. Because what happens now when we morph this sphere into the equirectangular projection like so, you can see what happens. So the North Pole at the top becomes this long stretched line, and so does the South Pole here at the bottom. And what used to be just one line where the sphere just continues, I mean, it doesn't have a start or an end, it now became the edge on this rectangle here. So if we just animate this, I can talk about it a bit more. So watch again closely what happens with the line here at the top. That long line kind of becomes the point here. And this has some kind of important consequences, because when you're working with this equirectangular projection, so say you want to edit this image later on in Photoshop, you can't just do whatever you want along that top edge, because this needs to merge up perfectly into that North Pole. So if you're just making a dark area here and a very light area here, in the end what you will see when this sort of gets wrapped together in the panorama, when you look at it in an interactive viewer, well, you will see that there's some segment here, which is going to be darker, and another segment here, which is going to be brighter, but it'll look very, very strange. So when you're editing these files, you have to be very careful with the top edge and the bottom edge. And the same holds true for the side edge here, the blue line, because again, in the sphere, this just wraps up into one, you know, it just continues here without any blink of an eye. Whereas if you're editing this edge here, make it a lot darker because you think it looks better and you make this area lighter, again, when it wraps together and you're looking at this panorama interactively, you will see this discontinuity here where a sudden jump in brightness out of nowhere appears. And what you also want to be thinking of is the kind of filters you apply. So if you're applying something like the levels or contrast or brightness filter in Photoshop, this is not going to be a problem because it treats every pixel the same. Or given a pixel's brightness, it'll do the same thing no matter where in the picture the pixel is. As long as it has one particular brightness value, well, it'll be transformed in the identical way as any other pixel with that brightness value. However, there's also a bunch of more localized filters, like the clarity filter, for instance, in Lightroom, or the shadows and highlights filter. That does some very localized changes. So it might decide to treat these couple of pixels here very, very differently than the ones over here. And when you wrap this together again and you look at your interactive panorama, it'll just become a weird oddity out of nowhere. So what can you do in these kinds of situations? Well, you can export your panorama to cube faces and then work with these, but we'll cover that in a separate quick tutorial. So back in PTGui, we have our panorama editor, and that shows you the equirectangular projection. But again, if you want to see what the result is in the end, you can always use the preview button up here and you just get the interactive view of whatever you see in here. So because if I change the grid again, for instance, and I look at the preview again, you will see the grid in here as well. So whatever you get here is exactly what you see in the background picture here, except transformed into an interactive viewer so you can look around it. Another thing you can do is you can also use the detail viewer, and then you get the full resolution preview. Again, it's interactive and you can see the full resolution preview of that area. And in particular, you can use that to inspect the zenith and the nadir area, the top and bottom edges, which are not so easily inspected in the equirectangular view of the panorama editor. Another option you have for previewing this whole panorama is by using the actual preview function, because what you see here is just a preview on the fly of the images, but it's not the full preview as you would get by rendering the full panorama with different blend modes and different interpolators. However, in order to get a quick preview and not mess with your final export settings, you can use the preview tab, because here, and you can see it already suggests a lower resolution, here you can just get a lower resolution preview and then also open that in the PTGui viewer. And then you don't have any grid lines as well. So this uses, again, the blender and applies all the different things that the final panorama also would have just with a lower resolution. And finally, of course, you can export your panorama in the Create Panorama tab with the full resolution. But when you're exporting this, you are getting a JPEG. You usually don't get some kind of interactive thing. And some people expect there to be an interactive viewer that just falls straight out of PTGui. That's not the case. You just get a JPEG and then you'll need a separate viewer for that. And there's a whole bunch of professional solutions like Pano2VR or KRPano for displaying your panorama on a website. You can use a whole bunch of different online platforms to host your panoramas. Or for a quick preview, though, you can also use PTGui's own export to web function up here in the tools menu, publish to website. And I'll show this in a separate little quick tutorial how this is used, but this will actually present you with a little interactive viewer in case you really, really need it and you just want to send something quick off to your customer. So much for viewing your panoramas. Finally, let's just have a quick look at two more tabs that we haven't discussed so much, and that would be the image parameters tab. In this image parameters tab, well, you have, as you can see, image parameters and lots of them. You have your positional parameters here at the beginning, so where in the panorama the image is. You have a bunch of photographic settings here. You can adjust your exposure offset and a whole bunch of other parameters. And what people usually don't know is, in case you need to adjust some of these parameters, you can do this individually. So let's have a look what happens if we do this. If I just increase the exposure offset on the first image, you can see it becomes a lot brighter in the right preview there. But what I can also do is you can also select multiple values at once and then just edit those all at once, like so. Now we got a super overexposed panorama. Or you can, of course, select several columns simultaneously, but some of these values can't be changed. Well, you can change these values over here, but you get the idea. So you can just select multiple cells at once in order to change those values in these. And the other tab is the optimizer tab. Now, this is a very advanced area, and I really don't want to go into the details here. Usually the default settings are perfectly fine, but you can click on the advanced button and get a whole bunch more parameters to tweak. And you can already see the little pop-up coming there. By pressing the shift button, you get some very useful help texts for the particular areas, and you can read up on what these different parameters do. So that's about what I wanted to cover in this tutorial today, but there'll be a separate set of little quick tutorials where I go into more details about these little things that I mentioned along the way, such as the publish to website tool, cube face conversion so you can easily edit your zenith and nadir, or using vertical type control points to accurately level your panorama. So catch you at the next tutorial.